Hello folks, so what I want to do in this video is to talk to you a little bit about self-aligned contact. Why do I need them? How do I make them? And what are the implications on my device? So self-aligned contact, and we can also call them SAC, because who doesn't like three-letter acronyms? So what it means is, it means that my contact to my source and drain is now self-aligned to my gate. So traditionally, in semiconductor technology, if you have a transistor, you used to have this contact, and it connects your source and drain, and it used to be, you know, far away from your gate, at least separated by a respectable distance, so it does not short with it. What the self-aligned contact scheme means is that now my contact is essentially self-aligned to my gate electrode, and it could very well land somewhere like this, where it touches my gate electrode, and it does not cause a short, and this transistor should still function. So it means this contact has to be now self-aligned with respect to this gate. So why do we need this, you know? So why do I need to bother about this? So there are two reasons I want to point out. That one thing which is driving the need for these self-aligned contacts is our, you know, the taskmaster called Moore's Law. So if you look at Moore's Law, it essentially requires me that, you know, I keep on reducing my gate pitch by this very aggressive amount, and I reduce it by half in every technological generation. On the other hand, when we talked about scaling, we saw that, you know, the gate length isn't really friendly to Mr. Moore, and the physical gate length for our transistor, it has really been scaling only as 0.9x with every technological node. So a 30 nanometer technology node has a gate length of around 30, and even a 21 has somewhere in that same range. So what has been happening is these contacts have been coming much closer to the gate. So over here is also plotted this gate length plus the distance for two spacer. So this is, you know, your gate length per two spacer, and this is plotted over as the pitch. So if you subtract the gate length plus two spacer, that is the amount of space left for your contact. So if you look at 90 nanometer technology, it had, you know, 120 nanometer of space for my gate and spacer, and I had 200 nanometer space to land these contacts. If I had a transistor, I had, you know, 200 nanometer space to land these two contacts, and so this was quite okay. But what has been happening is that this pitch has been scaling very aggressively. So the space I have for landing this contact has been decreasing by, you know, a very aggressive pace. And you can see that in a 30 nanometer, 32 nanometer technology, I only have 30 nanometer left to land these contacts. And if you continue this same path, which doesn't look very sustainable, what it says is that in 20 nanometer technology or lower, you essentially have no space to land these contacts. So these contacts have to now land on top of your gate. And this is one of the reasons that, you know, there's no space left for these contacts to, you know, land freely, with this leaving this space between my contact and my gate. So I need to go to this self-aligned scheme. Another big thing, you know, which is very important, and you can only understand if you understand lithography, is that one of the reasons which is again driving this self-aligned contact scheme is these overlay issues. So let's say you have, you know, this is your gate lines, and these other ones are, you know, your contact lines, or it could be, you know, very much the other way around. So this, you know, there's a set of gratings which you could be defining by pitch doubling, say self-aligned or double patterning. But then you have these contacts, and these contacts are essentially, they are too close to each other, so they have to be placed on separate mask. and you will have some misalignment between each of these mask and this your bottom gate electrodes. And that was fine if you had, you know, one mask, but if you have these, you know, if you have four different masks for patterning these contacts, you have to align, manage each of them to, you know, land up correctly. So these overlay issues are becoming again very, you know, they require you to build these self-aligned schemes. So even though if you have a large amount of misalignment and you land somewhere else, you still make sure that you land up and make a contact to your source and drain. So these two reasons, you know, if you look at just these two charts, it becomes very clear that at 22 nanometer technology, there was a need to move to a self-aligned scheme. And in fact, that is what happened. And if you look at this announcement from Intel on their 22 nanometer technology, that, you know, one of the titles of the paper said that self-aligned scheme was used for this technology. And this is one implementation showing how this could be done. So in their technology, they use a high-k metal gate. So your gate is in fact metal. So if your contact comes and lands over here, so your contact comes and lands on top of your gate, it will essentially result in a short between your gate and your source drain. So definitely we don't want to do that. So what they do is they add three extra process steps to make it a self-aligned scheme. So what they do is they have this, they make this gate electrode and they recess it back. And they fill it up with nitride. So this is filled up with nitride and you nicely polish it. And now, you know, your contact to your gate is made somewhere far away. It made, you know, not in this plane, but somewhere behind this plane. And now when your contact come and land on top of your gate, so they have this nitride, which essentially prevents it from shorting to this gate electrode or this gate metal. So it's shown over here. And by using this nitride, they are able to achieve this SAC or this self-aligned screen. But it comes at the cost that you add these three extra process steps. And shown here is you know, the main you know, one of the main advantages that you get with this self-aligned scheme. And shown here is the actual TM picture, which shows that, you know, it's not the best day for the contacts are not having their best day. So they are, you know, quite a bit misaligned. They were supposed to land somewhere here, but this contact got misaligned and it pushed out in this direction. But since we're using this self-aligned scheme, part of it could, you know, still land on the source and drain and over here, and you essentially still are able to maintain contact to this transistor over here. So, you know, it shows that so if you didn't have a SAC and, you know, you're essentially, if you had some misalignment, your percentage of your dyes in your wafer would just fall off along this cliff. But if you have this SAC scheme, then you essentially, even though you have this 15 or 20 nanometer misalignment, 100% of your transistor are still connected and your dyes are, you know, passing qualification. So this is one of the, you know, this is one of the main advantages of going to a SAC scheme. So what's the catch with the SAC scheme? So one of the things which become worse if you go to a self-aligned contact scheme is essentially your parasitic. So your coupling between, this is your gate and this is my source and drain contact. So I get a lot of coupling between my gate and this source and drain contact, because essentially all that is separating this contact from my gate is just the spacer material over here. So that increases a substantial increase in this capacitive coupling between my gate and my drain. And shown here is this simulation result from Synopsys, and As expected, it shows that this gate to contact coupling could be in fact even bigger than my gate to my channel or gate to my fin coupling. And that's of course not good. It's not good for digital circuits, especially not good for analog circuits. You get some relief to this by when you etch your metal. So we remember we did a metal etch back to form our SAC. So this reduced the height of this gate metal from the tall to at least made it slightly less tall. So that helps to an extent in reducing this fringe capacitance, but still that's a lot of fringe capacitance that you add, not fringe capacitance, but the capacitance between your gate and your contact, you increase that substantially in this self-aligned scheme. But nonetheless, there's no other option left. So, we run with the options we have, and people have implemented this SAC scheme in 22 nanometer technology. So when this announcement came out later last year, Intel made a lot of brouhaha about implementing this SAC scheme, and suddenly, the NAND guys, the flash guys, and the DRAM guys, they came from the woodworks and they say, hey, what's the big deal? We have been doing this since a long time, and in fact, that is the case. So shown here is this NOR flash technology from 45 nanometer. And again, for a NOR flash, you need this bitline contact to land between every two adjacent cells to connect to that cell. And they did, in fact, have been using this self-aligned scheme. So there's shown in this tungsten contact, and it lands in this self-aligned way between these two flash cells. So they have been using it for 45 nanometer, and then suddenly the DRAM guys came and say, what's the big deal? We have been using it even longer, and in fact, shown here is this scheme from 65 nanometer DRAM technology, and it uses this one transistor, one capacitor. The capacitor in this case is a trench capacitor, so it's digged into a trench inside your silicon. And surely enough, you can so this is your capacitor, this is your transistor, and you can see the bitline contact which is connecting to your transistor. It's it's self-aligned, and it lines up on top of your gate when in this case it's a poly gate, and you can see that it clearly is self-aligned with respect to this transistor. So clearly you can see some another point I want to drive home is that once we have learned enough to see some common grounds and some common scheme, and this SAC scheme is suddenly you see it sprinkling over from DRAM to your NOR flash, to your 22 nanometer Intel logic technology, and you see that this Moore's law and this alignment requirements are driving this to become more and more pervasive across a variety of technologies.